start my day with love, when I start my day with love, that's what I get, all right, is love. I start my day with love, when I start my day with love, that's what I get, all right, is love. Love, 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 love. That went awesome. What great huggers and singers and joyful, love-filled people we are. And so let's affirm together our founding unity principle. There is only one presence and one power in the universe and in my life, God, the source of all good. And our Lawrence vision statement, united in divine love and joy, we celebrate a peaceful and abundant world for all. And our Unity of Lawrence mission, we are a thriving spiritual community, sharing love, building bridges, and inspiring transformation. And so it is. And now time to be inspired by the wonderful Green Spirit Band as our musical guest.
We're grateful to be back. I was checking my calendar. We were last here in June, so it's been a little while, so we're glad to be back.
It's our favorite Thanksgiving song.
As we come around to take our places at the table, a moment to remember and reflect upon our wealth. Here's to loving friends and family, here's to being able to gather here together in good company and health.
And may we be released from all those feelings that would harm us. May we have the will to set them up and let them down. For heavy are the satchels full of anger and false promise. May we have the strength to put them down.
May the light of love be shining deep within your spirit. May the torch of mercy clear the path and show the way.
May the horn of plenty sound so everyone can hear it. May the light of love be with you every day.
And may we wish the best for everyone that we encounter. May we swallow pride and may we do away with fear. For it's only what we do not know we have grown afraid of, and only what we do not choose to be.
May the light of love be shining deep within your spirit. May the torch of mercy clear the path and show the way. May the horn of plenty sound so everyone can hear it. May the light of love be with you every day.
As we bless our daily bread and drink our day's libation, may we be reminded of the lost and wayward souls, the hungry and the homeless that we have in every nation. May we fill each empty cup and bowl.
May nothing ever come between or threaten to divide us. May we never take for granted all the gifts that we receive. Being ever mindful of the unseen hands that guide us and the miracles
miracles that cause us to believe. May the light of love be shining deep within your spirit. May the torch of mercy clear the path and show the way. May the horn of plenty sound so everyone can hear it. May the light of love be with you every day. May the horn of plenty sound so everyone can hear it. May the light of love be with you. May the light of love be with you. May the light of love be with you every day.
Thank you so much. And it is a perfect Thanksgiving song. Thank you. And now it is time to welcome back up here Jay Pryor, speaker, author, executive coach, lay member of this congregation, and a wonderful being of light and inspiration. So welcome, Jay.
Thank you. Ooh. Hey, everybody. Before, I like to do some housekeeping first, because when I go into meditation, I'm going to ask you to breathe this way. So I do it pretty much every time now. But I want to do some, it's called polyvagal breathing, if you haven't heard of it before. The notion is that we have our vagus nerve that runs from our spine all the way down and has tentacles to every one of your organs. And so breathing is a way to reset your nervous system, your parasympathetic nervous system. And so it's a tool that I use. It's a tool that a lot of practitioners use who meditate, and especially when I need to polyvagal breathing is what I do. And it's so easy, right? Because all it is breathing in through your nose and breathing out through your mouth. But when you breathe out through your mouth, you breathe out longer than you breathed in, right? So simple. So if you breathe in with your nose at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you'd want to breathe out to like 5, 6, or 7, right? So let's just practice. Take one deep breath in, and I'm going to count for you. Breathing. What is short for me? Out. See? Even if I take a short breath in, I can go out longer. And then the next time, I can always breathe a little deeper and go longer in, right? So then that second breath in. So when we go into meditation, I'm going to ask you to take a couple of those breaths, and now you know what they are, so I don't have to do that part. So I'm going to get rid of that housekeeping. And the next housekeeping I want to do is invite some folks to join us. It's been fascinating to me, and I'll share a little bit more about this in a second, I think. It's been fascinating to me how much this congregation has attracted to it mediums and mediums telling their stories. Lately, as of late, it's been the last three or four months, we've had Suzanne Geisman here, we've had Shannon Musgrove here several times to do workshops, and it's been just a big conversation in this group. And when I speak, I often call in my folks, and we often do that here. So I just want to take a minute to invite any and all light beings who have passed over for me. I'm inviting my mom, my dad, my brother Michael, my sister Christy, my Aunt Jane, my cousin Ruth, my friend Chris Griffey, my friend Enola Charity, Vi Hamilton, Bevan Kidney. And as I know now that as I start to hear their names, that I can know that that's because, at least, and I'm making it up, I don't care, they're here. So I invite you to do the same. If you have folks here you'd like to join us, who've crossed over, if you'd like to have them here today, and I just invite you to think of them. Anybody you think of, if you want to say their names out loud, you're welcome to. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Karen's here. Tammy's our dog, yeah. Bob, no. Yeah. Welcome, welcome, welcome all light beings that are here for our good and know that we are here to connect today. I want to back up a little bit. Suzanne Geisman was here a couple of weeks ago. I'm sorry I'm keeping my eyes closed right now because I want to. So I'm just going to tell you that. When Suzanne Geisman, if I haven't told you all that I'm an egomaniac by now, I am. So just so you know, the ego is always running. And if you really stop to listen, which is what Reverend Jen Hutchins asked you to do last week, if you were here last week, I forgot to say welcome to the people on Zoom and Facebook. Reverend Jen Hutchins last week asked you to monitor your thoughts. It's one of the things she said, to monitor our thoughts. And as I monitor my thoughts and know that one of the things that I like to share are things that people have asked us to do. So Suzanne Geisman was here a month or so ago. She's a big mentor of mine. And she said that normally when she stands up to speak, she has like an outline. And that when she stood up in front of this congregation, she just let go and let spirit come through her. And of course, my ego said, well, if I do that all the time. Right? Because I'm an egomaniac, and I told you that, right? So when Kathy asked me for a topic, every single time what I do is I just make something up. Like, I'm not kidding. I don't know. I'll talk about this. And I try to make it as generic as possible because I don't know what I'm going to talk about until I get here. So this time I said to Kathy, look, can I just say something like you are loved and like just come and find out because I don't know what I want to talk about this time. Every medium person who has come here has asked us to listen for snags. By a snag, that means something that somebody says that just caught your attention in that moment, right? And so I didn't know that I have been doing this forever, but how I've always come here to talk to you is I've just prayed myself up and I get open as possible and I listen for the snags. And so by the time I get here, I have had these snags that I'm gonna know that's popping up, right? So this time I did it on purpose. I just said to Kathy, can we just say you are loved? Because I know that that's always a topic I'm talking about. And then, like, let me just wing it. So what I want you to know is that I've had a rough week, right? And I've had a week of a lot of, my human being has had a week of a lot of fear. And fear is a very dense emotion. Anger, fear, all of those things that that take us out of that knowing of us ourselves as love, right, is dense. And so I will tell you that I don't feel as light as I normally do when I've really been prayed up and like I've got light shining out of my eyes, right? That happens sometimes. But I do want you to know that I have just said to my guides, hello. And then weird shit happens, like Holly's compelled to write a note. I don't know.
That was Karen.
Right. See, you never know. I'm telling you. So the point is that today I did pray up, and I'm just going to spew to you whatever comes to me. And the first thing that came to me was that we've had a lot of people talking about how they access spirit and or their guides. And so one of the things I wanted to tell you and share with you is that I've had a process for years before I come up and speak, before I do anything, where I tap on myself a lot and I shake around like a dog and I like do all this stuff to get myself lighter, right? Because we're made of light and this human body is dense, right? And the density, for me anyway, feels like it blocks the light sometimes. And so I do whatever I can to, when I tap on myself like this, I literally imagine that I am made of cardboard paper. And you know, do you ever do that thing where you're a kid and you put holes in a black cardboard paper and you hold it up to the light and then you have a design or whatever, right? Mine was always just torn paper. But that's what I imagine when I'm tapping on my chest like this, that I'm literally putting pinpricks in my heart to allow the light in, right? And so since I've been doing this process and since I follow snags, I've been in this inquiry for a long time around, you know, what's next for me in my coaching practice? And like, I don't know, And I thought I was going to launch this coaching school in January. And then I just had this big, like, oh, no, that's not it. That's not what's happening. So I'm still, like, in this weird inquiry. And so what I want you to know is that I feel like, as always, I'm being guided into different levels of spirit. And the first thing that I want to do is acknowledge this congregation for being my, what, you're like my master, my teachers, or like you hold this space for me where I learn and I grow and I keep getting bigger, and you keep showing up to like be a part of that. And that I just want to acknowledge and appreciate you as we're coming into this time of Thanksgiving. What thanks, what gloriousness you are. And what a, I think, like this space, okay? This is a holy space. And it's not holy because something holy happened here, right? It's holy because we're all holy. But this space has an energy of people who have been doing deep, deep work. This space has an energy of humans who do deep, deep work. And we are so privileged to be able to come here and do this work in this space. So those of you who, like, don't come regularly, like, if you come and you listen to Jen Hutchins tell you, there's only three things I want you to do. I want you to clear out toxins, she said last week. Start eliminating toxins, toxic relationships. Meditate every day, twice a day if you can, and just observe the thoughts that are going on in your head. That's all she said. Those three things, right? Well, if you come here and you hear her say those things, and then you walk out the door and you let yourself go unconscious, right? You just go, whoop, well, we'll be back next Sunday to figure out what Jay says, right? I promise you that even then, if you pay attention, you will always be guided to your next level of growth. But I also promise you, if you keep coming back here and you intentionally say to them or whoever it is, because I know that God is love, and that's what I, when I say all the prayers, I said, love is our power of protection. Love is the power of protection. Love is my God. And I know that then when I on purpose come here and say, I'm going to allow myself to be guided by the snags, I'm telling y'all the depth that of healing that I have experienced is profound. So I am not sure why it's important to me yet. I don't know all the answers yet about this inquiry that I'm in. But what I know is that in my first book, in my book that I wrote almost 10 years ago, one of the things I said very specifically in the book is that I want humans to know that they're loved. And one of the main reasons I want humans to know that they're loved is they just behave better. I'm not kidding about that. When I was in a place where I thought nobody loved me or I wasn't loved, I could be as crappy as I just, fuck, who cares, right? I can just be as crappy as I want to be because I'm not loved. I don't have any responsibility to love people. But now that I know that I am loved and I am loved, right, even if I behave badly, that is a knowing I have that I always come back to. It is a healing thing for me to know. And so in my book, I said, I want all people to know that they are loved. And one of the reasons is, one, they behave better, but two, because it becomes this healing, right? It's turned into a healing. And what I have gleaned and started to gain over the last years or so is that I think that part of this lesson for me is that the reason I want to know that I'm loved, the reason that I want to know that I'm not just the skin bag, is because when I allow myself that and follow those snags, I can actually heal myself from my past by being guided to do that. So that sounds obscure, but I'm going to tell you a story right now that Charles Fillmore said one of our 12 powers is our imagination. And when it comes to people on the other side or what happens when we die or all that stuff, you know, it's all made up in here, maybe. And it just feels good to me, so I don't care. I don't. But I want to tell you a story now about forgiveness, because for me, I talk about this in my book, where I honestly believe that for me, I can't hold any anger. I don't want to hold any past resentment. I don't want to hold on to anything. And throughout my life, part of my journey has been to get willing first to let it go and forgive, and then the second one is to do it, because I have to get willing first. So those of you who may not know me may not know that I am a transgender human. I identify as a non-binary human. I use they, them pronouns. I was assigned female at birth, meaning they looked at my genitals and they said, it's a girl. And I lived in woman's skin for 35 years before I took testosterone that made me give me this beard. And I walked as an undercover white guy for 18 years. And then I went off testosterone, which has my lady body is now back. But that's important to note for the story, is that I'm a trans person. And as a kid, I wanted to be a boy and related a lot to boy things, and especially this particular thing. That's important to this story. When I came out as a young lesbian in 1984, a priest told me that I could no longer come to the Catholic Church to take communion if I was practicing homosexuality. I told him I didn't need practice, and I left the church. I did. And I was hurt, because for me, my religion was so deep in me that it was like he had ripped something and taken something away from me, right? So I was hurt, but I was a giant hurt and not doing it, right? So I just shut the door on that. I always still had my own individual faith, my own individual relationship, but I shut the door on that. It was last year that I was in an inquiry. I'm always looking if there's something like, oh, is there anything in my past I need to forgive? Is there somebody yet I need to soften into? I still have a couple of people in my life I need to figure that out about. But it dawned on me, and I'm in the shower one day, and I said the words out loud, oh, I need to forgive the Catholic Church. Oh my God, I need to forgive the Catholic Church. So I said this out loud, I need to forgive the Catholic Church. And that next day, my friend Jenny's birthday was coming up, and I was in a place not feeling like I had any cash, but gifts are her love language, so I was looking for something to give her in my jewelry box. Now, folks, I've lived in the same house. Jessica and I moved into that house in 2010, and I've lived in that same house ever since. And my jewelry box, I've cleaned it out several times since then, right? Same jewelry box, always. I go to this jewelry box, and in the jewelry box is this medallion that's around my neck. And it was tarnished black. You couldn't even tell what it was. Now, also around this time, I had been in an inquiry for a while about whether it was okay for me to get a St. Christopher's medal, because St. Christopher was, I just thought it was my patron saint when I was a kid, but I felt kind of guilty because I'm not Catholic and religious iconography and blah, 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 right? So I never bought myself one. I also have a very powerful relationship with Jesus and Mary, and I've even thought about a Mary medallion, because throughout this time, I have, like, through unity and you, I have transformed my relationship to religion and to those people. So I have a relationship with Mary, and I have a relationship with Jesus, and St. Christopher was my saint. So I find this medallion, I go to my sister's house, and I know where her silver polish is, and I polish the thing, and it's gorgeous. It's in the shape of a four-leaf clover. And if you know me also, you know that being an Irishman is fun for me, and all my tattoos are all Celtic. So there's not a more perfect medallion for me. I start looking this up on the internet. There's very few of, they don't even hardly make these anymore. And on the back of most of them, it says, I'm Catholic, call a priest. But on the back of the one I found, it says, it has the four, and they're called the like Fab Four or Famous Four, and it's Jesus, Mary, Joseph, and Christopher. Okay, so I get this thing, right? And I don't know that this is happening at the time, and this is what I want you to get, because you're not always going to know that you're being guided, but you are all the time. And this is what if you have any message today, it's you're always being guided, whether you know it or not. So within a week, I had to attend a funeral. It was a Catholic mass, and it was for someone who had died by suicide. Now, the other piece that I was a suicidal youth, and I attempted suicide, And it was a part of my, the reason that I tried to kill myself was because I thought I was going to hell for being Catholic. And for sure, if you were a Catholic back then and you died by suicide, we were taught you're going straight to hell, right, without a handbasket. So I was like, fuck it, the music's better. Sorry about my mouth. The music's better, I don't care. And that was my thing. So I go to sit to this. Now I'm not aware that this is anything happening, right? But I go to this mass, and for the first time in my life, I'm at this mass for somebody who took their life by suicide, and this priest was not anything but love about this, and not anything but honoring about this human being. And I had this tiny piece of me healed, and I didn't know it at the time, but I did. And then within the next 3 weeks, I was sent to three. Notice the medallion is a four. I was sent to three more Catholic mass funerals. The second one, the next two, were in the town where I grew up. My siblings and I had to go down there. The first one was for the family that I grew up around, and I saw every member of that family, and I was able to tell them and be full of love and tell them that I loved them and that I appreciated them in my life, and I had a little healing, and I didn't even know it. The third one happened literally a week later. Our cousin got ran over by a tractor a week later, and we go down there, and the priest that's there is this gorgeous man who has the Holy Spirit flowing through him. And I don't know about y'all, but I've rarely met a priest that has a Holy Spirit just flowing through him. But this guy did. He was beautiful. And I talked to him, and I held it. He held my hand. And he was very effeminate, just so you know, also. Maybe family. But he held my hand, and he looked me right in the eye, and I told him about how I could say to him, you're so beautiful, and you have the Holy Spirit flowing through you. Thank you. And I said, you know, a priest told me when I was 18 years old that I couldn't be Catholic anymore because I was gay. And this man has a collar on. And he looked me in the eyes and he said, I'm sorry. And I got a little healing. And that time I knew, and by now we're on the third one. When I get back, another friend of mine dies who was a diehard Catholic. And I'm like, oh, for crying out loud. Because by now I know something's going on. Y'all, this next last funeral was in the actual building up at the St. Lawrence Center, where I was told that I could no longer be Catholic. And the person who was supposed to officiate the service was the same priest. So, I'm ready. I am going to walk in, and I'm going to look him right in the eye, and I'm going to say, I forgive you. I am ready. I get there. He's not there because he's on his deathbed. This other priest does a service. I pray the rosary with them. I'm like so complete. I'm like, I'm so done, right? I'm like, oh my gosh. But I go ahead and get a blessing. This priest wasn't full of the Holy Spirit as far as I'm concerned. I didn't feel anything. I was like, huh, that's interesting. I go around and I sit down, and I swear to God, it was like a physical sensation where I felt my butt hit the seat, and then the organ started playing. And a soloist started to sing the Panis Angelicus, which if you were raised Catholic, you probably heard every Christmas. My mother sang the solo of the Panis Angelicus every Christmas our entire lives. Until when I was 16 years old, she said, honey, I'm too old, and I want you to take the solos. I hadn't heard the Panis Angelicus since I was 16 years old. And my mother was singing to me. And I was healed. So I never take this. I wear this every day. I never take it off. I was mind blown, right? To back up skip one detail. When you're a Catholic kid and you go through confirmation, you choose your Christian name, right? I wanted to choose Christopher because I was secretly a boy. But I couldn't, and we had a sister who died, and so I took the name Christine as my Catholic name. But in my mind, it was always Christopher. So on my medallion, I have Jesus, Mary, Joseph, and Christopher, which I get, like I'm good with Mary and Jesus and Christopher, like I get the connection. But the Joseph was like, that's weird. And I'm like, well, I figured Joseph just goes with Mary and Jesus, right? Not a big thing. I'm not kidding y'all. It was about a week later that, I get a text from my friend Pam, who's often a source of light for me, that says, hey, have you seen what the Pope said about trans kids? So I look it up. Pope Francis is telling the Catholics, if they have a trans kid, to pray to St. Joseph. Because Joseph accepted Jesus just the way he was. So now St. Joseph is the patron saint of trans kids. I got Jesus, Mary, Joseph, and Christopher all on my medallion. I was sent to 4 funeral masses. And each one of them was a significant healing for me. You are always being guided, I promise you. And even though it feels like, oh God, what am I gonna do? Sometimes, right? It feels like that. It literally feels like, oh God. The answer is always right there. And it helps if you're conscious enough to notice that you're being guided. It helps if you're conscious of your thoughts. Like, we're always practicing in here to notice those thoughts. And again, like Reverend Jen said, now Reverend Jen was polite about it. She said, if you really notice your thoughts, you might notice that you're not as spiritual as you think, right? I will say, if you notice your thoughts, you might realize you're kind of a, right? And I know, because I notice how my ego will go crazy, right? I consciously pay attention to my thoughts, and I've been practicing watching my thoughts for so long, and they still can slip past me. But paying attention to your thoughts and being in this moment and noticing is how we hear those snags and how we know that we are always, always, always divinely guided, whether you want to admit it or not. I guess that's what I wanted to say. So we're going to have them come up and do some music for us, and then we'll go into meditation. And talk some more.
That was great.
Hard to follow that, so we'll just sing.
Music speaks louder than words. It's the only thing that the whole world listens to. Music speaks louder than words. When you sing, people understand.
I'm sorry. I was so moved, Jay, I didn't turn the page. No offense, music speaks louder than words. Sometimes the love you feel inside, it's lost between your heart and your mind. The words don't really say the thing you wanted them to.
But then you hear in someone's song what you've been trying to say all along. And somehow with the magic of music, the message comes through.
Music speaks louder than words. It's the only thing that the whole world listens to. Music speaks louder than words. When you sing, people understand.
The longer I live, the more I find
that people seldom take the time to really get to know a stranger, make him a friend.
But the power of a simple song can make everybody feel they belong. Maybe singing and playing can bring us together.
Singing and playing can bring us together. Singing and playing can bring us together again.
Music speaks louder than words. It's the only thing that the whole world listens to.
Music speaks louder than words. When you sing, people understand that music speaks louder than words.
Music speaks louder than words. It's the only thing that the whole world listens to.
Music speaks louder than words when you sing. People understand.
If you want to take a moment to just get comfortable in your chair for a second, wherever you are, let's take a couple of those polyvagal breaths, right? Deep as you can, and then out longer. One of the things that I do is I let spirit unwind me sometimes, where I just stand there and they kind of move me around, and if you're open to it, you can close your eyes. And if you put your hands on your lap with your palms facing up, if you're so inclined. How I started feeling spirit first was feeling like circles or waves were in the palms of my hand. So as you get present in this now moment, you might be able to feel that energy that's swirling outside your skin bag. And as we go into this, I want you to note that who you are is not the skin bag. And we practice that knowing in here on purpose. We weave that knowing that we know now into the new thought world that Myrtle and Charles paved for us. And then we are building on it, that knowing that we are light. So if you can imagine now that light, like a shaft of warm light coming down from your source into your crown chakra. That light coming down now over your third eye, coming down your face, melting that warm source light all down your face and your mouth and lips, down to your throat chakra, over your shoulders. Now breathe that light into your heart. Some of you have had a lot of dense feelings lately. Fear, rage. Let that light break apart that density right now. Let that light shift your focus. There is a knowing within you that you have the power within you that is greater than any circumstance before you. You have a deep, deep knowing of this. And as we connect into that, I want to invite you, whatever it is that fear is about, that unresolved pain, resentment, anything that blocks your light, I'm going to invite you now to be open to healing it. And to yourself, say the words, I'm willing, maybe I'm ready, to release, to forgive, to allow. And as we go into the silence, I want you to hear all the support that you have. And with this resolve that who knows what's going to come for you, but when you pay attention, I know that you have a healing coming. And it's going to draw you into a greater light than you've ever known. Let's be still for a minute and just listen. This room, wiggle your fingers and your toes. Thank them before you go. We come back here. Y'all, I don't know where that noise came from. I wasn't talking. I guess it just started, my microphone just started fuzzing. I don't know if you heard that, but I opened my eyes and said to Avery, what is that? And he was like, I don't know. So I couldn't do anything but smile because I'm like, I hear you. They hear you now. So Yeah, maybe. So anyway, as we come back here, thank you. Before I go, really briefly, I have to tell the story because I keep getting bugged about it. So just really briefly, my siblings and I, before, you know, we were raised Catholic, so, you know, we were taught essentially that we were going to go to purgatory, and however much people prayed and paid to get us out, that's when we'd get out, right? So we've always had this curiosity about what it does happen, right, when you die, like what the heck's going on. So our brother Mike died in 2017, but he was the oldest of us, and so we would always hammer and be like, dude, when you die, you better come back and tell us, and blah, 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 right? We'd have, blah, blah, blah. Well, I mean, he actually did kind of appear himself to Kathy at some point, but moreover, what I know about is that these snags, right, if you really pay attention, over the past few years or so, I am so crystal clear now for myself. I just have this knowing about, I know what happens when you die. You slip out of your skin bag. And I thought that the whole time. But we've literally just been having people come and tell us that over and over and over again. And this morning when I woke up and we were sitting in bed with Jessica, I had this song pop in my head, which was, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. And I thought to myself, I have never given my brother Michael credit for orchestrating all of this knowledge coming to us and me and my siblings about what happens when you die. We have just, you know, told him it was his mandate, and then never once have I given him credit. And if you know my brother Mike, he likes credit. So I have to say it because, brother, thanks. I love you all.
You say your heart's been turned to stone. You say you want to be left alone. You say love only made you weep and moan. Well, let me tell you something that you know in your bones.
Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock.
You say your soul's like a dry riverbed. Stop waiting for the water. Long ago you said you better pray all night for the rain instead. Love comes like a tidal wave over your head.
Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock.
You say waiting for love takes too long. Dulls a sharp mind, weakens the strong. Well, you may be right, but you may be wrong. Love can make a mountain come tumbling down.
Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock.
The river washes over every woman and man. Feet in the gravel, mud in your hands. Nothing can stand against love's command. Every boulder turns into a grain of sand.
Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock.
One more.
Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock.
How perfect. When that fuzzy sound was on in the sound of silence moment, I was picturing a waterfall and being washed and released. Yes, water. Yeah, love is the water. There's always room for more. What a powerful message and music, as always, brought in perfect harmony. We are so blessed. And so as our ushers come forward for our time of thanks, I invite you to join me as we hold our gifts to this loving community in our hands, love in our hearts. Let's affirm together, divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive, and so it is. As the love offering is collected, let's join Holly in singing, How Could Anyone Ever Tell You? So as our ushers come forward again, here is our prayer of thanks to listen to. We are grateful and we bless the flow of good that supports our unity community. We bless the givers who give their time, talent, and treasure. We stand in the knowing that the flow of good goes forth only to return again and again. And so it is. Amen. And a reminder that we are so filled with support in these times more than ever before, at a time we need that support more than ever before. And so in this time of joyful living, if you have thoughts of otherwise, there is a fabulous number, 988, to call. We have the Burt Nash community right here, and they have saved many lives over and over. And one of our former board members, Michaela, used to serve with the Kansas Suicide Hotline and was trained in that. And so we are loving and we are full of support when we feel less than loved, and we are blessed for that. So a special welcome to our guests today. Thank you for being here. We never know what will happen. It's part of the joy of being in this unity community. We go with the flow wherever it takes us. And so if you would like to find out more about us and the unity movement of Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, we have a welcome packet in the foyer. Please help yourself and ask us any questions. We are a wide open book. Our Sunday Lunch Bunch is meeting at Jason's Deli, South Iowa, on 3140 Iowa. All are welcome. It's just a bunch of people that want to eat lunch together. So join us. You are welcome. And remember that Open Meditation with Phil Roger meets on Tuesdays at 6:30. We have Lessons in Survival Italian with Francesca meeting this afternoon at 4 here. And now it is time, speaking of board members, past and present, Cindy Smarsh from the board for a special announcement.
Yay, Cindy. Woohoo! You guys are so sweet. Hi, good morning. One of my great pleasures this last year has been serving on the Unity Board.
And I'm board secretary, so I'm one of the nominating committee members, which means it's time for us to find new board members because we have four people stepping down from the board, and we need eight, so we have four remaining. And so if you have any calling within you that you'd like to help serve the congregation in this way, basically what this means is we oversee all the activities and the business of the church. There is not a full-time minister here, so we are the executive body of the church. And so we just take care of anything that comes up, so everything that comes up. And I have found it to be one of the most joy-filled, loving experiences, honestly. I mean, it is business. We take care of business. But it's a wonderful experience together. Even when we've had to make some tough decisions, I just feel like the spiritual nature of this community has shined through. And so if you feel called to serve in this way, feel free to ask me questions or any board members. Board members that are here, why don't you raise your hands? I think most of the board is here today, the current board. So feel free to ask any of us questions. And then there's an application to fill out. It's two-sided. And so they're on the table out there in the foyer. So please take one, fill it out, give it back to me, or Lene Pettengill is also on the nominating committee, and Janet Morgenstern, who's not here today, or Kathy Moreland. You can give it to Kathy in the office. So, and we'll look those over, and we may be approaching some of you, too. We have some ideas in our minds of who might be really offer something really wonderful to the board. So, thank you so much, and we'll get back to you on that, how that's going. And now, one of our board presidents.
One of them. That's great. Just a brief synopsis of what's been happening in the board. We are getting a bid this week for dusk to dawn lights outside here, because it seems late at night that when we walk out, you have to get down the steps and several steps out for the motion sensor lights to come on. So we're doing that. We have also affirmed the new YOU leaders that have stepped up and said that they would be willing, if we could get at least three people to come to youth, such as Robin Lewis and R.J. Pryor. And so we want to undergird them, and we have as a board undergirded them by putting some funds in the budget for next year. And so let's all pray and bring this into being. Yeah. And also, we are in a search process. We have a committee that's going to be looking for a minister of record. We have been told by Unity Worldwide that we need to have a person who is credentialed as a minister with Unity. So we're in that process. And we have new guidelines coming out for our guest speakers, and we really want to thank Cindy and Lene for the work they did to get those drafts up and going for us. Also, speaking of stepping up, it's wonderful to be in a community where people step up. And Pat, I'm going to miss her last name, Phillips, thank you, has agreed to lead us in a ministry with Family Promise. And so we're very excited. We'll be doing that in lieu of doing Link. Link has a lot of people volunteering right now. So we're really thrilled that in February we will be part of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you to all eight of our current board members. And it truly is a beautiful gift you give yourself to be a board member in serving at a deeper level. And so every year there are four positions available, 1 year term or 3 year terms. And so it is a gift you can give yourself and our Unity community if you are already a Unity of Lawrence member, to step into that next beautiful waterfall of love. And so a few opportunities besides the nominating November time. Please come and join us at 2 on Thanksgiving Day for our annual Friendsgiving meal if you don't have other plans already. We are providing the turkey, potatoes, and gravy. All you need to bring is a side dish or dessert to share. It's a great time to share great food with great friends, and all are invited. That's 2 o'clock this Thursday. Holiday projects. We are sponsoring 2 programs this holiday season. The Willow Domestic Violence Center needs $25 gift cards to Walmart, Target, Kohl's to purchase gifts for their families. Dare Drop-In Center is accepting donations of new winter gloves, hats, and wool socks for guests who use their services. Please have all donations delivered to the church by Thursday, December 14th. Many thanks for helping those in our community. We will be remaining after the service on Sunday, December 3rd, for the hanging of the greens. Plan on staying to help decorate the sanctuary for the holiday season. Join us next Sunday when Robin Goff brings us the message, "More Than We Dared to Ask, Practicing Conscious Gratitude," special music with Lana Marie Haas. And now it's time to rise as you are able to sing together the peace song. As we lower our hands, let's say together the prayer of protection. The light of God's